Good afternoon. My name is Camila Salcedo, and I'm going to share my story on IVF. Okay, so being pro-life is about believing in the value of every human life, from conception until death. We believe that every human being is unique and has dignity from the moment of his or her conception. Most of us join the pro-life movement because we believe that abortion and or euthanasia are the greatest human rights violations. There is, however, another pro-life issue that is talked less often about. Many pro-life organizations have mentioned it or done some work on the topic, but I believe that there is not enough awareness about the moral implications of this issue. I'm talking about in vitro fertilization, IVF. In vitro fertilization is known as a fertility treatment. In it, embryos are fertilized in a petri dish, in a laboratory, outside the mother's womb. After an intense hormonal treatment, the biological mother's ovules are extracted and placed in a petri dish with the biological father's sperm. They grow in the petri dish for 4 to 8 days, and then they are implanted back in the mother's womb. When I first heard that IVF wasn't pro-life, I was confused, very confused. After all, its purpose is to make babies, right? I mean, I was made via IVF myself, so I knew most couples, when they did it, they were very well intended. And yeah, I'm an IVF baby. Yet I wasn't willing to simply ignore the moral problems of this procedure, and I completely understood that the fact that I was personally benefited by IVF didn't make it morally right. I started researching, and it turns out IVF is not as good as it seems. First, IVF separates procreation from the act of conjugal love. Due to the way in which your body works, most lives are begotten from the encounter of love between a man and a woman. Nature has made it so that children are made in this act of great love, of mutual self-giving. And children have the right to come from this great love. In IVF, instead, it's more of a technical process. Yes, it does make children, but outside from that encounter, and at very high costs. Second, perhaps the biggest moral problem of IVF is the way in which it treats already conceived lives. In most IVF procedures, many embryos are fertilized, way more than the clinic expects to transfer into the mother's womb, because many are not expected to survive in the petri dish. The problem is that oftentimes more embryos survive than the mother intends to have transferred. So those embryos that are not transferred are either killed, frozen, or used for scientific research. So yes, the process normally entails the destruction of many human lives to give birth to a few or even a single life. As pro-lifers, we know that since life begins at conception, IVF involves the abortion of many human beings in their very first stages of development. And even when no embryos are directly killed in the process, the probability of natural deaths in IVF is significantly higher than in natural conceptions. After all, for women between the ages of 20 to 30, 83 to 91% of natural pregnancies survive the first 7 weeks, while only 30 to 35% of transplanted embryos lead to live births, not to mention the embryos that died in the petri dish. Third, IVF opens the door to many other morally troubling possibilities. For example, IVF makes prenatal genetic screening possible, with which parents can choose which children will be born and which will be killed, based on genotype alone. This attitude is very contrary to our belief in the value of every human person. No one has the right to decide who will live and who will die, based upon a few preferred characteristics. Genetic screening is performed before implantation, but many pregnancy clinics also offer the option of MFR, multifetal pregnancy reduction, in which parents can decide to abort a certain number of children in order to avoid giving birth to more babies than they intend. Both of these cases, of course, are examples of abortion. Additionally, many clinics offer the service of sperm or ovum donation, by which an unknown donor or vendor can give his or her sperm or ovum, which adds a third party, an external biological parent. So this means that the child is both conceived out of the context of conjugal love and from two parents completely unrelated to each other. There have been several instances in which these children try to look for their biological parents, or try to look for their biological parents' medical history, while those parents are protected by anonymity. In addition, many of these donors or vendors have tens or even hundreds of children. To finalize, IVF also lends itself to surrogate motherhood, which, although it is done with consent, compromises the dignity of underprivileged women, whose bodies are treated as merchandisable goods, as means to satisfy the ends of the couples. With all this being said, I understand that IVF is something that many couples recur to with good intentions, not knowing the moral implications of the procedure. Infertility is a heavy burden on many couples, and it is understandable that they want to use all the resources they can so that they can reach their dream of having children. I understand, and it is rough, but they should hold on to hope. Technological advancements have brought up many other options that attempt to cure the problems that make couples infertile. Yet, there are means that simply should not be taken, no matter how good the end is. With this, I want to share a little bit of my parents' story. Well, my story, because as I said, I was made via IVF myself. After several months in which they continuously tried to conceive, my parents realized that they were struggling with infertility. They went to their OBGYN and decided to begin treatment for my mother's endometriosis. She went through several surgical procedures to clean out her fallopian tubes, but they didn't work. They also tried hormonal treatments, but those didn't work either. In the end, they felt they had only one option, IVF. Yet my parents, both of whom are specialized medical doctors, felt there was something troubling about the procedure. At the time, they did not consider themselves pro-life, and they were not religious. Yet, they felt that there was something troubling, and after thinking for a while, they decided to go through with it. They used their medical contacts to investigate the fertility clinics nearby, and chose the one that they trusted the most. But, in the process, they found out that another nearby clinic had been in trouble for using third-party ovules without the parents' consent. My parents also asked the clinic to fertilize very few embryos and to transfer them all, because they were very troubled by the ideas of killing, freezing, or donating them. They even asked themselves if it was morally right to spend so much money on this expensive procedure while there was so much poverty in the world. In the end, they decided for it. And although the first two procedures didn't work, I was born from the third, and I still am an only child. I didn't know much about the story when I first found out about the moral problems of IVF. I became really worried about the possibilities. So I was very thankful when I learned that they tried to make the procedure as moral as possible. However, I do want to clarify that no matter how many measures the couple can take, IVF is never morally permissible, because the process always entails the separation from procreation and the act of conjugal love, and it will still sanction many deaths for the birth of a very few babies. When I first realized about the moral problems of IVF, I was very troubled. I didn't know what to think of it. I was made via IVF. And I constantly asked myself, why don't more people know about this? I do want to say that, as a Christian, I knew that the morality of IVF didn't take away my dignity in any way. And I knew for sure that God loved me the same as any other person. I also knew that God loved my parents infinitely, despite having performed those IVFs, and he was all in helping them realize the moral wrongs of IVF and help them heal. I prayed a lot about it. I honestly think I haven't prayed more in any other point in my life. I wanted to know the story better, and I wanted to talk about them. I just was too scared. During that month, however, and without me raising the topic, they started talking about one of my twin brothers who died in the womb. I had already heard about him before, but not much, really. We didn't see it as pertinent in our lives. That had happened way too long ago. But during that month, and I like to think because of my prayers, my mom dreamt for the first time that she was breastfeeding him. I later learned that after losing him in the womb, she tried to forget him, because she felt that not doing so would have been ungrateful for the daughter who did survive. Consciously, she felt fine. Yet for many years, she kept dreaming that she had forgotten her son. It was a recurring nightmare, where she would be with me, and she would suddenly remember that she had forgotten him somewhere, or forgotten to feed him. Yet, she never actually saw him in her dreams, until that month. It was then when she started talking to my father about naming him, because they heard from church and friends about the importance of naming unborn children. They chose to call him Jose, even though I voted for another name. Although I later realized that it was the same name of San Jose Sanchez del Rio, the saint who had accompanied me in my prayers through the whole month. I don't know, I just thought it was beautiful. The first time I learned about the moral problems of IVF was when I read another IVF story. I'm grateful that it brought my prayers, the rich conversation with my parents that have helped on their healing. I'm also grateful for how all of this made me realize the importance of raising awareness about the moral issues of IVF, of which very few people know about, even within the pro-life movement. After all, I was conceived via IVF, but I still don't support it. Would I be here without it? I don't know. But I believe in moral truths, and what's wrong doesn't become right from me benefiting by it. The means never justify the ends, even if the end was me. Thank you.